How many are new to this Geek Night? Thanks for making.
Good evening all. So this session we'll see about building real-time data pipeline with Apache Kafka. So yeah, there are a lot of terms in this title. We'll uncover this during the session. Myself, Nagarajan, I'm working as a developer here. So how many of you have worked with Kafka before? Cool. Okay. Let's start with a simple example. So if you have worked with Unix or Linux for some time, you would grasp what is going on here. So here we are making use of Linux utilities to do a vote count on a file. So I will take this as a simple example as a pipeline or an analogy to a pipeline. So where we are making use of that operator is called pipe symbol. So we are passing the output of one command to the new next command. So it forms a sequence or a pipeline. Yeah. So then what is data pipeline? So a simple is like the data flow between different components or different services in your application. How the data pipeline can be, it should be loosely coupled so that it won't break or it won't it need on to wait for other stages to complete or something else. It should be automated. It should be able to scale up to the growing needs and error recovery. So if you take a pipeline, we say that it will have different components. So if one of the stage in your pipeline breaks, the pipeline should have the capability to, should have the support for the other service to retry or recover from its failure. Let's take a use case. So we have a web application and we want to track number of visitors per page. It's a very simple analytics kind of thing. So where we want to have this visualization and the inputs we will receive is like this events. So what is the URL, what's the IP address, when it's being visited and those things. So for this use case, if you want to build a very simple naive application to suffice this use case, this very naive solution. So but there's a web client. So whenever a user visits a page, it can hit a endpoint at the your server URL. So there we can do the aggregation, like per page you can increment a counter, and if you want to do aggregation by time period, we can do. Okay, so this is a very simple application for this use case. Imagine tomorrow if someone comes and see, okay, we want to build a recommendation engine for this application. So the input is same, even the recommendation needs to know how the user interacts with your website. What are the URLs they are visiting? So now the client need to send the data to two different service. One is for your aggregation or analytics one, another is for your recommendation. Again, this internal implementation of this aggregation or recommendation can have multiple stages. It can have its own filter stage. For example, in a recommendation, you want to do recommendation only for your logged in users. So some websites have your non-logged-in version and also has logged-in version. If you want to build a recommendation, you would build only for the logged-in users. So you will filter the data there itself. So only the logged-in users you will move to the next stage. And then we'll do a processing. And yeah. So imagine as a business, we'll need more capabilities. You'll add more functionalities to your application. So if you have this way, so the web client needs to send the data to all the applications. So as you can see, there are So the web clients is going to grow, the number of users is going to grow, and for each visit they need to hit three different URLs to send your data. So this system will be a little brittle. So what if there is one endpoint down? For example, if the recommendation URL is down, so you will lose the data from the web clients. So we need a better way for the clients to post the data and for your systems to process the data after that. So let's imagine you have a box here. So the web clients will send the data to that box, and whatever application needs that visit history, they can pull it from that box. Okay. So in this situation, tomorrow there may be other services which requires the same data. So this box should be able to support the system. So, and also, as it's a web application, and some of the things need to be real time as well. For example, in the analytics case, you want to track the number of visits per page in real time. But in a recommendation engine point of view, you don't need to have it as real time as possible. You need some data to be available. For example, if you want to, we can do a recommendation run every one day or something else. So different services will need different timeliness. For example, metrics will do it in real time, and recommendation can do it on batch wise. So that walk should be able to provide support for two different use cases as well. So whatever that block we are seeing, that should have these following characteristics. So it should support for high throughput ingestion. That means the number of users is going to grow. So it should be able to handle the throughput of ingestion. Like if there are millions of users going to use your application, there'll be a lot of that events really coming to the system. So this box should be able to handle that. It should store the data in a fault tolerant way. And this service should be highly available. And another thing is, it should be able to support for concurrent processing. So if you have lot of events, so if we do it in a sequential way, it will take a lot of time. You won't get a benefit out of this data. So the system should be able to support concurrent processing, and also as well as ordering guarantee. So if you have a system, you want to track how the user's page visit pattern is. So what is the links he is following? So from a link A to link B, and link B to link C. So if you want to understand the user's behavior, you want the data to be processed in order. Right. And yeah. So with the following characteristics, one such tool that supports these characteristics is Kafka. So the first part is the actual definition from the Kafka website, where they stated Kafka is a distributed streaming platform. It allows to publish and subscribe streams of records. In our case, it's a page visit event. And this is a simple description. So it's a distributed, partitioned, and replicated commit log service. So this term commit log, it comes from the database systems as well. So the commit log is a file where you'll store your events in a durable manner. So it's just like writing the data to a file. So there they use a term called as commit log. Yeah. Going on, the Kafka has, these are the four different APIs from Kafka. So it has producer APIs and consumer APIs. So the producer APIs can supports for the users to send the events to the Kafka system. And there are other two things called as connectors and stream process. We won't go through the connectors and stream process today. So we'll just give a brief introduction to connectors. So connectors allows us to, so there are two different connectors. One is sync connector and source connector. A sync connector is a application or a plugin that will read the data from your Kafka, and it can put into any sync you provide. For example, the sync can be a HDFS storage or a MongoDB or S3 whatever it can be. A source connector is like a reverse way. So if you have a data in your database and you want to do a capture of the updates happening in your database, you can use a connector there, which will listen to the updates in your DB and it will put the updates as the event in your Kafka. And stream process, so stream process, it both the input and the output is Kafka. So it will listen to inputs from Kafka, it will do transformations, or it can do any aggregations, whatever you want to do, and it will write back to Kafka. So it's an abstraction over your producer and consumer. It acts as a both a consumer and a producer to your Kafka. In between, there are APIs to which it provides APIs for us to provide support transformations, aggregations, and all. Yeah. So Kafka, they call it as a distributed streaming platform, but actually it's a combination of your queuing and a publish subscribe thing. So in a queuing system, we will have so actual queues, like someone will produce a data to queue, and if some subscriber reads the queue, the data will be gone. The subscriber reads the data and it acknowledges that it processed the data is gone. But the queue supports for parallel processing. So there, for a queue, there can be multiple consumers. Each consumer will get its own data, it will process, and it will move on to next data. In a publish subscribe system, it's kind of a broadcast. Queue is a one-to-one and publish subscribe broadcast, where we can have multiple subscribers to one data. And so in this case, so treat Kafka supports for broadcast scenarios as well. So we can write a data that can be read by multiple set of services, the same data. And also it can be done in a parallel, concurrent way. Yeah. So the granular unit in Kafka is the messages. So that we refer different terminologies exist for the messages. Someone calls records, messages, events. So those are just the granular units where we will write, for example, in our case, the page view event, it's a message for Kafka. And the topic is the abstraction where we maintain the all your logical group of records or logical group of events. And the topic will be split into multiple partitions. So why we need to split into multiple partitions? Because we want to support for concurrent consumption and as well as ordering guarantee as well. So if we have only one topic, before that, so I'll explain what partition is. So a partition is just a file, it's a commit log file, where whenever you write an event, it will be just appended to that file. And so in case if you have only one file per topic, the limit is that limitation is that it cannot grow beyond the disk size you have in on one machine. So also if the consumers are consuming from the topic, it will be limited by the network bandwidth available on your machine, on the single machine. So they split into multiple partitions, where each partition can be a separate files, where it can live on different machines itself. So you are not limited by a single machine's capacity. It can be distributed, it can be consumed in a distributed way in different systems. And these numbers are offsets, are just an incremental sequence number which Kafka maintains for your messages. So whenever you write a message, it increments the number and assigns that number to that message. It's called as offsets. Yeah, as I mentioned earlier, partition is a ordered immutable sequence of records. So here we cannot go and update any data in Kafka. Whatever data is being produced, it will just update to the file. So only they're calling us immutable sequence of records. And Kafka provides ordering guarantee within a partition. Because each partition can live on different machine, that's the granular unit they came up with. But within a topic, across the topic, there is no ordering. But within a partition on a topic, there will be ordering. Yeah. So how does the partition being defined or determined for a message? So for every message, we can give something called as key. So just like a hash map, you will just like a hash table, based on a key, you will decide which bucket you want to store that message. Similarly, if you provide a key in a message, we can use that key to determine what is the partition I want to store. Also, while creating a topic, we have a control over how many partitions we want. Okay, and we will see the record format when we talk about producers. And another thing is, so we mentioned that Kafka provides possibility to process messages in concurrent way. So the partition is the minimal unit of concurrency. So only one thread can process a partition at a time. A partition cannot be shared between two different threads of a single consumer. If you do that, it will break your ordering guarantee. Yeah. So when we talked about that, the system in between your different the client, web clients and your other systems, we also wanted a storage system as well. We want to act as a storage system as well. So the Kafka cannot hold your data forever. So it has different parameters so that we can toggle how long you want to hold your data. So one is by time. So time defined. So from the time the event is produced to your system, how long you want to retain that message? It depends on the use case that we are building up to. Also, we can configure use this configuration per topic. We can configure the system wide, where it will be applied to all the topics. But if you want one stream of data to be available forever, you can configure that per topic. So it will override the default value. And it has options as for size as well. You can limit the data by size. So if you have only storage capacity of 100 GB, you don't want to go beyond 100 GB. If you go beyond, the cluster will be down. So you can limit by size as well. And so log segments. So when you talk about commit logs, we mentioned it's a durable way to persist your events. So it is not a single log file. A log file will be split into multiple segments. So we can configure the segment size so that so the segment size has an impact on your retention configuration as well. So if you have the default segment size is 1 GB and the default retention by time is 7 days. So for the 7 days worth of data, if you are not reaching the 1 GB limit itself, it resides on a single file. So if it crosses 1 GB, it will create a new file, it will close the old file. So when it comes to the point that this file has a records that is older than 7 days, but that file is not closed yet, that means that file is not reaching 1 GB yet, so it won't remove that file. So it will wait for the file to be closed and for a new segment to be opened, then only it can remove the older files. So if some cases we will wonder, like if we configure the retention time, there's a chance for your older data to be existing in the system. That's because of your segment configuration. And there is another thing called as log compaction. So slide which explains pictorically. So I mentioned that a message can have optional keys. So what log compaction allows us to do is, it can maintain only the latest event of that key. For example, if you maintain like a user ID and email address, if you don't want to maintain as all the record, all the history of the email address of that user, if you want just the latest email address, we can do a compaction on the topic where the key can be the user ID and the value can be the email, so that Kafka will remove that older messages and it will only keep the latest per key. So this also plays an impact on your log size or the utilization of your disk size. So far we have talked about what is the topic, what is the partition, block files and all. So this is a cluster setup, simple cluster setup, where we have different terminologies here, broker, cluster and zookeeper. So in Kafka world, each node in a cluster is called as a broker. And zookeeper is a separate tool, separate solution, which is a, you can call it as a distributed key value store, which Kafka relies on today to maintain metadata and as well as to elect controller nodes. I'll explain what is controller node. But going forward, the latest version of Kafka, they are planning to remove the dependency from Zookeeper. So only the Kafka broker itself is sufficient to run your cluster. So yeah, I mentioned controller. A controller is it's one node of your Kafka cluster, which will help you help us to elect leaders for partitions. So we mentioned earlier that partition is a unit of parallelism and partition can live on different machines. So if we group all the partitions of a single topic in a single machine, again we are hitting the limitation of the single machine. All the writes, all the reads will be limited by the throughput of your system. So you want to split that partition to different machines. So that thing, the controller node will help you to determine, okay, who can be the leaders of these partitions, and it will maintain the metadata. So to decide on the who's the controller, Kafka brokers relies on Zookeeper. So they will create something called a slash controller in your Zookeeper. Whoever creates that path first will be the controller. And also the there is a live connection between your that controller and the Zookeeper. So whenever that controller goes down, Zookeeper knows that, and other brokers will try to create that path. So yeah, and imagine scenario when there is a broker down for some time, and when it comes up, it thinks it is the controller. So in that case, it resolves the conflict by assigning a latest timestamp. So whenever a leader elected, whenever a controller elected, it assigns a latest epoch time to that controller, so that even if the older controller comes back, it knows that okay, there is a some other controller, latest controller available. I will not work as a controller. Yeah. So also we can see about how the replication is happening here in Kafka. So in this diagram, so we mentioned the partition leaders. So I have indicated in the green thing. So for a topic one, there is only one partition, that is partition zero. For topic two, there are two partitions. And for partition zero, broker two is the leader. For partition three, partition one, broker three is the leader. So in replication terms, for topic two, partition zero, broker two is called as leader replica. And other two is called as follower replica. So whenever, in significance of leader replica is, so whatever the writes and reads will happen only through the leader replica. So even though you have a follower replicas or copies of the partitions, reads and writes won't happen to that partition copies directly. It will always happen through the leader. And so the follower syncs the data between the leader and its own copy on the background. It's still 2.4. Yeah. So it's coming up in Apache 2.4. Yeah. So and in another concept called as in sync replicas. So in sync replicas is how many copies which are on track with your leader copy. So we can configure this parameter so that if you want the data to be very consistent, you don't want to lose the data, you want to make sure it is available all the time, we can configure a min replica so that we can get acknowledgement during a write, so that it is available in all those replicas. And whenever a leader, so in this case, if the broker 2 goes down, we need to elect a different node as a leader for that partition. So on that case, the whichever partition is in sync with the leader partition, sorry, leader replica will be chosen as a new leader. And we can configure replication factor, that is how many copies you want to retain or maintain. And we'll talk about producer. So Kafka provides a client's SDKs. So it has one thing called as producer API, which allows you to produce records. And we can have different ways of acknowledgement from that. So depends on our use case. We can choose between a fire and forget mode, just like if you want just push some logs to the log information or some not so super useful information, we can go with the fire and forget mode, that is acknowledgement zero. Just that the producer will try to send the message, even if the broker is not available or if the leader is not available, it won't care. Or if there is another mode called as acknowledgement as one, where it will wait for acknowledgement from at least one node, or at least the leader to be giving back the acknowledgement that the leader successfully persisted that event. And there is another mode called as acknowledgement all, which ensures that the whatever data we are writing, it will be available in all the replicas. So it should be available in the number of minimum in sync replicas that we have configured. And so by default the Kafka producer does batching. So it does it to improve your support your high throughput case. So there is a trade-off between your latency and the throughput. So by default it does batches, batching the messages. So there are two properties. One is batch size or linger MS. So the producer thing, it will wait for either the size to be reaching that limit or the linger MS to be reached, then only it will send the that records to the actual brokers. If you want the event to be very if you want a latency rather than the throughput, we can reduce the batch size and the linger MS so that whatever event that we are producing, it will be written as soon as possible. And the producer also has support to send a message asynchronously, where we can register a callback. So we don't need to wait for the messages, we need to wait for the acknowledgement. It will happen in background. We will register a callback where we can write logic like how we want to configure your acknowledgement. If there is error, how we want to configure and all, we can register the callback. And another thing is load balancing. So here in Kafka, there is no routing layer, just like in your normal application where you have a load balancer component above and it will rewrite requests to different nodes. In Kafka, we don't have such concept. So producer periodically refreshes the metadata about all the topics or the topic that which it is interested in. So what are the partitions available? Who are the leaders for those partitions? So whenever you want to write a message, it can directly contact that broker and write the message. So it need not to go through a routing layer, and then it need not to go through a different broker. So whenever it receives the error, if its metadata is not up to date, it will receive error, and then it will fetch the metadata again from one of the available brokers. And the configuration that we give in the URL, so in the producer API, we can configure the bootstrap server URLs. So where we can give multiple URLs, so in case if there is one broker down, it can communicate with the other brokers. We'll see a sample code at the end. Yeah. So it's a producer flow. So that one at the top is the representation of a message or a record. So it has a what is the topic it want to produce to. We can so while producing, we can define a partition on our own as well, or we can leave it to the partitioner strategy partitioner classes, and we can have an optional key which will be helpful to decide partitions. And the value is the actual message that we want to persist. For Kafka, every message is just a byte of records. So whatever format you want to write, if you want to write as a JSON, if you want to write in different format, we have to write our own serializer. It has a string serializer by default, and others some of the libraries exist for arrow serializer as well. But if you want some custom format, we can write our own CLI, sir, where we'll convert the whatever object representation into a sequence of bytes. And then partition is available. So by default, if there is no key, it chooses the partition in its own way. Now, from 2.4, I think there is a way to configure that as well. So in case you have no keys, how it should determine the partitions. But if you have a key, for example, in our use case, if you have session ID as a key and you want to keep the ordering in the session, so we can write our own partitioner to use the session ID as the key, where it will always select the same partition for the same session. And as I mentioned, so producer maintains a batch, and based on the batch size or a linker MS, it will try to send it to Kafka broker. And for some exceptions, like if the leader replica not available, which is a temporary error, so Kafka cluster takes care of alerting a new leader when the leader goes down. So the producer API already handles that on its own. So it terms that as a retryable exceptions. On retryable exceptions, it will retry for the so by default, it retry forever. So we can change the retry count number as whatever you want. So for the retrieval errors, it will try to produce the batch again. Yeah. And we'll talk about consumers. So consumers, so there are two terminologies, consumer and consumer groups. Just by the name, a consumer group is a one or more consumers. So here the consumer actually means the Kafka consumer object that we are going to use. So as we talked earlier, so the partition is a minimum unit of parallelism or minimum unit of concurrency. So which should allow only one consumer to process one partition. A consumer can process multiple partitions, but a single partition cannot be processed by a multiple consumers. So in this example, the consumer one processes partition one and partition two, but a partition zero cannot be shared across two different consumer objects, because if we do that, it will break your ordering guarantee. Yeah. So in consumer things, so there are two ways. So it's just a concept, but Kafka uses the pool based model, where the consumer can pull the records on its own time, on its own frequency. When you talk about a push-based system, so if you take a push-based system where the throughput will be limited by the capacity that the broker can handle, but if you go to a pull-based system where the consumers can get the data at their own rate, and position of the messages. So every message will have a sequence, as we talked earlier. So it is called as offsets. So when a consumer goes down and comes up, it needs to start it from where it left. So we need to maintain that position somewhere else. So internally, that it's maintained at some topic called as consumer offset topic. So it just increments the number, since it uses that thing offset. So offset is a sequence incremental number assigned to per message within a partition. So whenever we read a new message, it will just update the offset for that consumer. So the consumer zero read till 12 messages in partition two, for example. And how the consumer will tell what are the messages it has consumed. So there are two ways. One is we can make it auto commit. So when you start a consumer, if you enable auto commit as true, it will commit the latest record it received every 5 seconds. But in that case, it won't guarantee that whether we have processed that message or not. So when we pull a message from Kafka, it will just give a batch of records. So if we do it in a auto commit way, it will just update the latest one. But there is no guarantee that you have processed all the messages. So if you want that control, we can disable the auto commit and do a commit on our own. And replay. So since Kafka will persist the messages for the configure time, if a consumer wants to replay the messages from the start, It can just seek to the offset, seek to the older offset, it can process it. And in this diagram, so these consumers, how it gets assigned to the partitions. So there are two ways. One is range assignment and round robin assignment. So range assignment, it will split the, it will take the number of partitions in a topic, divide by the number of consumers you want to run, and it will assign to the consumers. If it is not a proper divisible number, the consumers at the start can have more partitions than the consumers at the end. So to balance it, there is another strategy as round robin, where each consumer will get assigned to the partition round robin way. And if the, so in a group, if the consumer goes down, so the group knows that, okay, one of the consumer is down, it will just reassign this partition to other consumer. So in this case, so there is consumer 0 and 1, 2, and if the 2 goes down, this partition 3 can be assigned to consumer 0. So that consumer group takes care of that thing. It is called as rebalancing in Kafka. Yeah. Okay. So we'll talk about delivery semantics. So we have three different things: at most once, at least once, and exactly once. So Kafka with the default configuration, it supports at least once. That means there's a chance for duplicate messages to be produced in your topic. Also, there is a chance that the consumers can reprocess the records it already has processed. That is at least once. So if you want at most once, that means there is a chance that your message may not get into the queue as well, or it may not be processed as well. It will just try for one time and it will just go. How we can do that is, so for at most once, we can set the producer acknowledgement as 0. So the producer will not guarantee that the message has been produced. It just tries once and it will just ignores that. And in the consumer side, it can choose for auto commit, where also it just receives the message, but there is no guarantee that it has processed that message or not, because the commit happens in background. Or you can commit just receive the message. Either you can commit after processing or you can commit before. If you commit before, you are not having the guarantee that you have processed the message. And exactly once is a harder problem to solve. And on a produce side, they have some concept called as idempotent producers, where they will assign some ID to the producer. So even if the, even so, example, the producer tries to send a message, producer has an ID and it tries to send this message. And before receiving the acknowledgement, the producer, the network got down, but the message is written in Kafka. So the producer didn't get that acknowledgement, so it retries the message. But the broker uses the producer ID and the offset, or the message ID, and then it will identify, okay, there is already the message has been written, so we need not to write the message again. So it it removes that duplicate writes. And consumer side, exactly once. So far it's been available through transactions. I mean only with the Kafka stream. That is, if you read from Kafka and write to Kafka, you can have a exactly once guarantee. But if you are dealing with some external systems, if you have a DB or if you want to write to it a API, so Kafka will not provide exactly once. We have to take care of that exactly once. So for example, if you are consuming a message and if you are writing to DB, so what happens if the DB fails? Or I return to DB, but before I'm committing to the Kafka, my consumer goes down. So that we need to take care of that. The Kafka won't support that. But with the Kafka streams, since the input and output is Kafka topics, it can handle exactly once through transactions. Yeah. So we talked about that pipeline earlier. So you want a data type pipeline to be loosely coupled. So for a pipeline to be loosely coupled, so one thing we shall, if you're using Kafka as the integration point, so one thing we are assuming is the format of the data. So if the producer returns the data in certain format, the consumer is expected to run a certain format. What if the producer changes its format? What if the producer removes the data, removes the field from your data? The consumer will break, the pipeline will break. So in order to decouple your consumers, we have to maintain the schema, the separate thing. It should not be a implicit understanding between your stages in a pipeline or service in a pipeline. It should be explicitly specified, explicitly maintained somewhere else, so that even if a new consumer comes in, it need not to ask a different service for its schema. You can just look up the schema registry or the central place where we maintain the schema to understand, okay, this is the format which is being written to this topic. I can read this format. So this term schema registry, there is one Confluent provides a tool called schema registry, where it stores the schema per topic, as well as it ensures the compatibility. We can configure compatibility. So when we evolve a schema, depends on our use case. If we want the older message to be read with the newer schema, we need to do a compatibility check. So we can configure that schema registry to do those. Yeah. I'll just quickly show the code. Okay, so I took this simple use case I spoke earlier. So we want to track the clickstream events. So I have a model here, just session ID, URL, IP address, browser and timestamp. And so these are the configurations which you want to mention. So first thing is the Bootstrap server config. So it specifies your broker IPs. So we can specify multiple broker IPs here. So if I have multiple clusters, multiple nodes in my broker, I can specify the address as a comma separated list, so that even if the one of the broker goes down, it will use the other broker address for communication. And as you mentioned, so for Kafka, any message is just a sequence of bytes. So you want to specify what is the serialization you want to do. So for key, we can specify string serializer, which is available by default in your Kafka client libraries. And for value, I want to write a clickstream object, so I have provided a custom serializer. It just does the JSON conversion. It uses the JSON object mapper and just converts my object to a bytes, sequence of bytes. And we talked about partitioner. So partitioner helps us to keep the ordering between your sessions. So if you want the events within a session to be ordered, so you want to have a partitioner class where we'll just take a hash code and then we can determine the partition number we want to use. So here I'm using the session ID. So the total partitions, we can get it from the Kafka itself. So for this topic, how many partitions I have? So for a given session ID, I can take a hash and do a modulus to determine the session ID. So this will be deterministic, so that at any given time, given the number of partition doesn't change. So for a session ID, it will be the partition which chooses will be same. But if you change the number of partitions, the ordering will not be guaranteed anymore. So a session can end up in a different partition. And we talked about the acknowledgement config. Yeah. Yeah. Based on session ID. Okay. It's not possible by default. If you want to do such thing, like if you want to consume a specific partition, we can any specific partition. But if you want to find out which partition the session lives on, then we have to maintain the data on our own. So consumer can consume from a specific partition. It has the capability to do that. But to identify the session and the partition, we have to maintain the mapping if you want.
the consumer can to answer my friend's question, like there is an API called Assign, so that a consumer can pull messages from a particular partition, but that is not advisable.
Yeah. If your use case depends on such scenario, you might. But there is a capability there. Yeah. So another config is the acknowledgement config, where you can specify whatever the configuration you want. And yeah. So this is just a configuration. Using these properties, we need to create that object, which we can use to send our messages. So for example, I have a clickstream object. I want to send this thing. I have a topic name, the clickstream, just. And so we saw the pictorial representation of the producer record. So producer record needs the topic name. It's a key. So I'm giving a session ID as a key explicitly and the value that I want to write. So here, by default, the send gives back a future, the Java future object. If you want to wait for that acknowledgement to be done, we need to wait on the future. You want to do the .get on the future. Or if you want to send in asynchronous way, we can just use the producer send and register a callback. So if there is a exception, we can decide on how we want to handle that exception while sending the message. So this is the producer part. So coming back to the consumer part. So again, in the consumer also, we need to provide the bootstrap servers, the broker address and port. And so as consumer works as a group, we need to configure a group ID. So it will be, so if you're running a different processes for a same consumer group, you need to specify this consumer group ID config as the same. And so enable auto commit config. So if you want to have a control on the commit, or if you want to control on the acknowledgement that we are giving for the messages, this messages that you are processing, we can disable this thing. Default it is true. Again, we need to specify the key deserializer and value deserializer, as we'll just receive the bytes or byte array. We want to convert it back to a meaningful object. And we talked about this partition assignment strategy, where we can choose between round robin or range. Range is default. Round robin assignment, it comes by within the Kafka client library. And there is another interesting thing called auto offset reset config. So when a consumer comes up the first time, so there is no track of that consumer in your system. So it's a new consumer. This configuration helps you to configure where you want to consume from, whether you want to consume the event that is produced from this point of time, or you want to read all the messages that has been in the system till this point. So default thing, you can read only the event that is going to be produced from this point of time. If you want to read the whole history, you can choose this option earliest. So it will give the consumers can pull the records from the start. Whatever the data is available in the broker, it can read it from there. Again, we'll use these properties to create a consumer object. Once you create a consumer object, we need to specify what are the topics it needs to consume from. A single consumer can consume from multiple topics as well. So here we are giving the subscribe function, it takes a list of topic names. So here we are just using a single topic name called clickstream. And so as we are doing a pull mechanism, so we want to do the pull frequently, or whatever duration that we want to do. So it will be just a ever-running loop where you will pull the check the whether the messages are not there or not. If it is not there, again you will retry. You'll just call the pod again. It's a live waiting kind of thing.
To partition, right? I mean.
Yeah.
Topic makes sense, but why would you have a consumer on a same topic from two partitions?
So
in your earlier slides, you were talking about in some cases where we will like, you know, message number 5 you are getting, and then message 7 you are getting from different partitions, right? Is there a valid use case, or is
so the partition is the unit of parallelism, unit of concurrency provided by Kafka,
right?
So the partitions spread across different machines. Each partition has a leader between different machines. Okay, so if you want to process that thing in a parallel way, you can spin up different consumers, or you can have different consumer threads with different consumer objects. But if you configure the group ID as same, that all the three instances of the consumer belong to the same group. So there it will share the, it will split the partitions among them. So one consumer will read a message from a broker one, other consumer will read a message from partition available in broker two. It splits the work. So if you want to do it in a parallel, in a concurrent way, you will use this.
So when you subscribe here, you are subscribing only to topic, right? We don't tell you anything about the partition.
Correct. We are not mentioning any partitions here. So here I'm doing only one consumer object. So this is just a runnable class. It gives a flexibility too. I can spin up another runnable so that it will also try to subscribe to the same topic. But if the topic has multiple partitions, the consumer group assigns split the partitions between them. So it has two instances of live running consumers, so it will share the workload between them.
So there is a configuration for the consumer group also? No.
For what?
There is a way we can configure the consumer groups, like we are configuring consumer here.
Yeah, so if we, based on this group ID,
okay.
So the different consumer instances knows where the, which group it belongs to.
Got it, okay. Thanks.
Yeah.
Broker, it's from the broker, right? But consider one use case, like I am designing one system. I'm recently added one consumer, but I want all the previous history messages too.
Yeah.
So you mean here the queue history or entire system history?
So whatever available in the topic. So Kafka retains the data for a configure time. So Kafka, it won't maintain the data forever. Based on your log retention configuration, it will maintain the data only for that configuration. So when the consumer starts and gives it the earliest reset configured earliest, so it can read it from the start.
Yeah.
Whatever available in your broker.
Yeah, it's clear. Okay, considering the same use case, like I want to take all the history information, I mean all the messages, how I need to design Kafka system? Or
that means you want to retain your data forever, or?
Okay, let's what? Take simple example, like I have two consumers, one producer.
Okay.
I'm running this system for 3 years. Recently, I added one more consumer.
Okay.
But that the consumer wants all the history to process something. It can be analytics purpose, or it can be anything. But how to solve instead of migration or inbuilt tools available in the Kafka?
Yeah, so if you want to retain the data for 3 years, first we need to set the log retention period for the longer time. We need to have that so much resource, so much disk space in your cluster. So if you have that enough resource, and if you have the configuration which will retain data for the longer period, it just this configuration will work there. It will just read it from the start.
Okay, it's purely based on our configuration.
Yeah, it's purely based on how we configure the cluster, how we configure the log retention. If you want to hold the data for that longer period, we need to configure it.
Yeah, otherwise we need to write some programs to push the messages from the beginning, maybe in a separate topic for the new consumer.
Yeah, but again, you have the problem that you have older records in different topic, newer records in a different topic. There is a problem that when you switch back to the newer topic. So there are certain problems. One way you could do a offline processing with a batch. You can have a dump in different storage. You can do the offline processing, and then once you are done with the offline processing, you can join this cluster.
So what I read somewhere.
Yeah. So New York Times maintains all the data in the Kafka cluster. So they have configured the cluster in such a way. few of them uses Kafka as a plain storage, it retains storage forever, and few use cases they are just using it as a high throughput messaging system, where they don't want to retain a message forever, they just want to pass the message between different systems in a high throughput way. Yeah. So coming back here, so once we subscribe to this, we can do a poll. Poll gives me the consumer records. So consumer records, it's a collection records, and where you'll get the batch of records from your broker, and we can do a for each on that, and you can do processing. Just it exposes that iTrouble, and you can do these things. And yeah, so since we have disabled this auto commit, we need to take care of committing the offset on our own. And yeah, so there are two ways. One, you can do a commit in asynchronous way, where you have a function called as commit async, and you'll pass the current offsets that you have recorded so far. So the offset is just a map between the topic and partition. So on this topic, on this partition, what is the offset that I have processed till? One way is to do async function, or you can do a sync function. Yeah. Do I have 2 minutes? Can I do a demo? Yeah, we'll just run this application. So I have exposed the API so that we can produce messages to this application. And in my local, I have a Dockerized setup where I have 3 Kafka brokers. So I'm inside one of the broker. Can show that. Yeah, so I'm running 3 brokers and a zookeeper container. So the broker is in a fresh state. We can see what are the topics available in my broker. So this is one of the internal topic comes with the Kafka. We don't need to worry about this. So creation of topic, we can enable, we can set the configuration to create the topics automatically. Whenever you want to trying to produce a message, if there is no such topic exists, we can make it to create a topic. Or if you want to have a final control over number of partitions that we want to choose and those things, we can create a topic beforehand and then we can produce a message. Here I'm going to create a topic beforehand. These are utilities available as part of your Kafka distribution, where we'll just use a bootstrap server, the replication factor, number of partitions for this topic, and this is the topic name I want to create. So I just created the topic. If you list it, it'll have 2 topics. Yeah, the clickstream is created. Now we can fetch what are the offsets or what are the number of messages available in the topic. It's not equivalent to number of messages. It just gives the latest offset of the messages in each of the partitions. Since we have created 6 partitions, it shows 6 things. So clickstream 0 is the 0th partition, clickstream 1 is the 1st partition, and this is the current offset. So it's just a fresh topic, you don't have any data, so all the offsets are 0. Now we'll just run the producer. Pushing the data to that. So I'm using a random session ID and things, so it should expect a different messages in different partitions. So if you do that offset check again, yeah, we have choose a random session ID, so it has been assigned to different partitions. So the partition 0 has 1 message, and partition 1 has 3, partition 2 has 0, so those things. And we can run a consumer app as well. We'll just print the messages there. Yeah, it just prints just print the messages that has been produced so far. Yeah. So also we have commands to check how the consumer group is doing, like whether it has any lag or it's lag between the messages that is available there. We can check there. We need to pass the consumer group name. So for on this topic, on this partition, current and log end offset is this one, there is no lag. So this will be useful to for your monitoring, or if you want to debug that why is the consumer lagging, you can use these utilities. Yeah, that's it I had. So these are the resources which can be helpful if you want to learn more on Kafka. So this is a book. I think it's freely distributed in Confluent website. You can go sign up and do download on this book. It's very helpful. And these two URLs, one is the actual Kafka's page and the Confluent one. So these are helpful resources if you want to explore more on Kafka. Yeah. Questions?
Work with that schema registry. Actually, people generally do some tweaks to avoid schema registry. So I'll come to that later. But my clarification is, in case we are using a schema registry, how does the producer know this is the schema registry? Do we have a way? Similarly, how does the consumer know the schema registry?
So if you take the specific example of Confluent schema registry, so we cannot use the plain Kafka producer that is available for Kafka clients. So you have to use the Confluent Kafka client, where they have a class called Kafka Avro producer or Avro Kafka producer, something like that. So where you have to provide a configuration that is the schema registry URL. And if you provide that, so it will, so if it's a new topic or if it's a new schema, it will upload that schema there until you get a global unique ID. And that it will append that unique ID as part of every message. So it won't embed the schema on all the messages, just will append that unique ID as a byte in your message and the actual message. On the consumer side also, you have to use a special consumer class, Kafka Avro Consumer, where you will get the ID from your message. You can look up in the schema registry, what is the schema for the registry, and you can use it to deserialize it.
Thanks. That's clear, actually. There is a tweak to avoid schema registry. That is what I have done once. But there is both good and bad in that. The good thing is that we avoid the cost of the schema registry. So we didn't prefer Confluent just because of their cost. And the tweak that people do is like they leverage the use of Avro itself to bind the schema also along with the topic. But again, the bad thing is like the payload is too much.
Yeah, it increases your payload size. Yeah, although if you use the Confluent schema registry, it gives a global unique ID for every schema. You can just do a maintain local cache itself. But again, the Confluent has a license terms. You cannot have a multi-node schema registry running without a license. Open source version allows you to run a single node schema registry. You cannot have a multi-node.
And again, it is too much costly.
Yeah.
Confluent.
Thank you. Please leave your feedback on the session here. Thank you.
Back sharply after 10 minutes. We have arranged tea and snacks for you in the pantry available behind. Thank you. Let's meet back around 7:30.
Shall we get started?
So for the people who are new to Geeknight and this is your first time, about Geeknight, Geeknight is a community event sponsored by ThoughtWorks to spread the knowledge, you know, for the communities across Coimbatore. You know, this happens every city where the ThoughtWorks is. You would love to spread this word and, you know, take this knowledge to more and more people. Thank you.
We can get started. Okay. Good evening, everyone. So before starting the session, a bit of introduction about myself. My name is Raju Kandasamy. I'm a lead consultant here. I run AR/VR practices here in Coimbatore. I'm also a game developer. So that will explain why I did what I did for this session. Okay. So basically, in this session, portable ML models, what we are going to talk about is that we are living in an era where we are producing more AI-based or machine learning-based models. Okay, in the past 5 years, there has been you know, tremendous amount of work went on here, and there are several trained ML models which are publicly available, published and available for the public to consume. Okay. We have talked about, you know, how to train models, you know, how to do machine learning, right? But we haven't discussed much about, you know, how to consume these models, okay? You train the model using Python, using some framework, and you test the model using same Python, right? And be happy with it. But what I'm going to discuss today is that how can we utilize these models that are produced and deploy it to environments like mobile phone, cloud, so that you can write microservices around the published model, or you can write apps that can use the, you know, trained model. Okay, this is more about consuming the model than producing the model. Okay, I'm going to explain the pipeline. Okay. From a machine learning framework where you produce a trained model, okay, how to convert this model into a format where these devices or cloud can make use of them. Okay. Of course, this is a very dry topic to discuss it. So to keep the interest, so I did a small game, okay. So before getting into the session, let me play that game so that we get a context of what we are talking about. And what I'm going to show you is the end result that is going to be achieved. Okay, so this is a half finished game, okay? And this is a puzzle. So I named this as Puzz Bunny. This game is like you have a garden, okay, where you seed carrots and you know, the bunnies attacks, okay? The way you play this game is that this is a 3x3 grid, okay? And each one cell that you see, there is a character in it. It will be either carrot or the bunny, okay? What you need to do is, once you touch one particular cell, it will toggle. If you touch bunny, it will toggle as carrot. If you touch carrot, it will toggle as bunny. Not only that cell, but top, bottom, left, and right. Its neighbors, excluding the diagonal neighbors, top, bottom, left, and right neighbors will also toggle. So I'll just, for the demonstration's sake, I'm toggling this bunny. You can see that bunny has become a carrot, and the top, left, and right top, bottom, left, and right neighbors has become bunny. Okay, so the target of this game is that you need to get rid of all the bunnies, okay, and make your garden full of carrots. Okay, so that is the target, right? Interesting game, right? Okay, now, so while developing this game, I found it very difficult to provide hints to the user. What if the user is at this particular state, okay? And he keeps on playing, you know, without any fruitful results, right? He wants to get a hint from the game to get his, you know, next moves. What is the next possible move? Can the game provide a hint, right? So this is where, you know, I thought, you know, let's bring in AI. I'll give you the thought process why we went for AI than the traditional algorithm-based, you know, hint. So now I'm going to ask my AI. Now this application is actually integrated with my ML model. So once I click start, it will start giving me the hint. So it is asking me to press here. So you can count the steps, how many steps the AI takes to solve this problem. Okay, step one, step two, step three, step four, and fifth step, I'm done. Okay, so within five steps, the AI is able to solve the problem. Okay, so this is the context, okay. Now let us go and find out, you know, how this thing is done, okay? I haven't prepared, you know, much of slides, but rather I would talk like, you know, how this model is prepared, going through the code and, you know, explain you how this thing is done. And for the sake of sticking to the topic, I will, you know, spend more time on the pipeline than, you know, explaining the game logic and all, right? Okay. Right. So in this discussion, we are going to talk about something called ONNX, okay? Open Neural Network Exchange Format. Okay, this has started sometime 2 years back. Now it is being adopted in several areas. Now Microsoft and Facebook is sponsoring ONNX big time, okay? So what ONNX and what it does? So on the left-hand side, you can see that we have numerous frameworks on ML, okay? We have PyTorch, we have scikit-learn, we have Caffe, we have Keras, we have MXNet, okay, multiple frameworks. The problem with these frameworks is that when you train a model and you persist the model, right, when you save the model, these models are persisted specific to that framework. Okay, when I train a PyTorch model and persist the model, I can only read the model using PyTorch library. It can't be used in a TensorFlow library or Keras. Okay, it's not portable, right? That's where ONNX comes into picture, okay? The ONNX is a framework. It's an open source library of components, which allows you to import and export between the persisted data formats. Say, for example, in this example that we are talking about, the game that I did, I have written a PyTorch-based machine learning algorithm which persisted the model in PyTorch format. Then I exported the PyTorch model to ONNX, and then from ONNX to TensorFlow. And from TensorFlow to something called TFLite. TFLite is the format which is used in Android SDK. Android SDK provides ways and means to consume the TFLite machine learning model so that, you know, you can make use of the intelligence that is persisted in the TFLite model, right? Not only that, so now this ONNX is becoming a kind of a framework neutral format upon which there are several things built. There is something called ONNX runtime, okay, which is being supported by Microsoft Azure and AWS. Okay, once you have your machine learning model which is persisted in ONNX format, it can be directly executed in Azure Cloud Platform. Okay, so what that enables you to do is, once you publish these ONNX models into any of the cloud platforms, you can write microservices around it, right? And consume the microservices in your mobile or web app or wherever you want. You just start sending the input that is needed for the neural network model, and you start consuming the AI output in your application, web application or mobile application, okay? So ONNX primarily allows you to get out of the framework dependency. You are not stuck with a particular ML framework. It provides you to, ways and means to interop between different frameworks, and also allows you to, this is the beauty of this one, consuming the pre-trained ML models. Any of you have already done machine learning? Cool. So you could have already, realized how much resource it takes, right? More than the resource, it's the time, time taken to train a model, right? And the computing resources that are taken to train the model, okay? You can't keep on, retraining the model in every place you go and use it. So once you have a pre-trained model in ONNX format, it can be used from anywhere. And then the concept of model zoos. Already used model zoos? Model zoos are repositories for GitHub-like repository for pre-trained ML models. You can go to a model zoo, download a pre-trained ML model, and you can start consuming them. As I already told you, Microsoft and Facebook is investing big time in writing this ONNX compliant runtimes in their respective cloud platforms. And also it enables you to produce production-ready models. What do I mean by production-ready models is that once you persist your trained model in ONNX, we call it production-ready. Okay? Right. So let's come to our case study. So a little bit of intro about this game. We already seen that this game is 3x3 matrix. Yeah.
What do you mean by persist your model?
Saving the trained model.
Okay.
Saving the trained model as a file. Okay. So this is a 3x3 matrix field. You toggle one cell, it toggles self, left, right, top button. And the goal is to get rid of all bunnies in the matrix. Right? This is the rules of the game. I have actually written a PyTorch-based solver. So I may not be going in detail of what this code does, but I'll give you a brief idea of is it readable? Yeah, okay. So here is this neural network which is formed, okay. I have one input layer, which is FC1, and then I have three hidden layers, and there is one output layer, okay. This is the model, and the way it is trained, I'll give you a little bit of introduction about the algorithm, the training algorithm which is made here. This is called, this algorithm is called Markov decision process. A little bit of introduction about a Markov decision process here. This is our game, okay? The goal of the game is to reach the diamond. In Markov decision process, we have something called agent. Agent is the player who plays the game. And action. Actions are the possible directions that I can make, like move forward or move up, move left, move right, right? These are all the possible actions. Then I have a goal to reach. Then there is something called reward. Reward is something when I go and reach the goal area, I get some reward. And I have something called penalty. Penalty is something like if I take a wrong move, then I get penalized. So let's keep the scientific term aside, Markov decision process. This is something called behavioral enforcement, right? As parents, what we do to our kids, right? When we want to encourage some behavior, we give rewards to them, right? We give gifts or chocolates to enforce the good behavior. And whenever they do some mistake, you know, we, you know, penalize them, right? Either scolding them or beating them, right? So this is the behavioral enforcement. The same concept is applied in Markov decision process. The way it is applied is you have the list of unique actions that the player can make. For every player move, the training algorithm will start giving a reward or penalty. Okay. Then the neural network, depending upon the score that it receives for every action that it takes, it will optimize its graph and weights. Okay, let's see that how it happens. But in this case, in our game case, it's not the final target, but I started giving rewards for the states which are closer to solution. Right, this state is one touch away from reaching the goal. This state is not, but this state is again one touch away from the goal. So this is a penalty case, and these two are reward case. Okay, so let's get back to training the model. Okay, so if the way we train the model is that the brain is nothing but the neural network model that I've shown you earlier. I supply the level matrix, and I would like to, you know, give the reward based on the steps. Okay, the neural network model should not take, you know, 1,000 steps to, you know, reach the final goal. It should be short, right? So I'm inputting the number of steps, the earlier steps that it has already taken to reach this level, and what was the last reward. Okay, this is what is fed into the training model. And I asked the neural network model to give the next possible action. So initially it will be errant, you know, it will be giving, you know, whatever it thinks randomly, okay. But then once it gives a possible action, I start toggling it. Then I check the state, okay, whether is it equal to the goal state or is it near reaching the goal state. Then I start rewarding it. If it has reached the goal state within 5 steps, you can already see that I'm giving a very good reward, like 20, okay. And if it is, you know, erring too much, then I start penalizing it like, you know, minus 0.02 and, you know, multiply with the number of steps it has taken, right? So I start penalizing the neural network, okay? So I'll just show you a graph how this turns when it comes to learning. So this is an actual scoring graph which is taken from this while training this model. As you can see, when it started, you know, it went into the negative because it has started penalizing, it has started getting more penalties. Okay, and it learns, and there comes a point where it started receiving reward. Once it gets started receiving the reward, you can see that, you know, there is a spike. It has learned that what is that particular move, you know, which makes, you know, get the rewards. And after some time, you know, it balances out. There is not much more to learn. right? So the curve becomes more of a straight line. So that's where we made a cut that this is a good enough learning for my game to play on. Okay. This is core actually. This is the number of iterations that it took. The number of possibilities that I have given. So this is like 1 lakh different combinations. There might be repetitions as well, but I keep on generating random grids of 3x3 matrix and started inputting that. Okay. Right. And finally, I persisted that this as a model. This brain.save is nothing but it saves the model. Brain.save, it just persists that as a disk file. Okay. Right. So now that I have this, the brain is nothing but the trained model, but this model is specific to PyTorch. Okay, now I need to make this model production ready, right? I want to consume this trained model in Android device. Okay, I can't directly use the PyTorch model because Android doesn't support Python. And there is no PyTorch support in Android, so I can't directly use this trained model. So let's see the pipeline. This is now, now we are reaching the point where we start making, yeah.
Thank you. So while training the model, it appears you didn't provide any external training data. It generates the training data by itself. Is that right?
Yeah, it is correct. So what I generate is a random state. I mean, random inputs to be fed into the model. So this Markov decision process, right? It works that way. It has a game state. If you are near to the goal, you get a reward. If you are far from the goal, you get a penalty. That's how it works. And to get the game state, I just start providing the grid in a randomized manner. There is no input file as such where you have 10,000 different combinations. No.
All right. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So this is the first level that we do. Let me go back to the PPT. So the way it is done is that first, I need to convert the PyTorch model into ONNX, and then ONNX to PB. PB is a TensorFlow protobuf, and then PB to TFLite. So this is the steps in which I converted the PyTorch model into TFLite. So before getting into that, I'll introduce a tool called Netron. Netron is a tool which is used to visualize your models. So this is the model. Okay, so this is the PTH model I persisted. So this is the graph data which is available in the model. You can actually relate this to the neural network model that I have earlier written. So this, right, 160, 120, 60, 60, 30, 30, 10, you can see that model appearing here. 120, 11 is nothing but this input to 120. Input size is 11, and the first layer is having 120 nodes. So 11 to 120, and then 120 to 60, and then 60 to 30, and then 30 to 10. So this entire model can be visualized. So you can use this as a debug tool kind of thing, right? If you want to get into the persisted file, and if you want to see the architecture of the neural network, so this is the tool that you need to. I'll come to this, why we need this, in a short while. So the first one is, you know, converting this PyTorch into YNNX. So to convert it, we use the torch.ynnx package, and I do a brain.load, and then I start preparing a tensor. Okay, see, this brain.load is nothing but brain.load does loading the same PTH file which I persisted, right, in the previous step. Okay, if you are wondering what is that doing, it loads that same PyTorch file, and I start preparing one tensor, one input tensor, and ask the neural network to select an action to perform, and then I use the torch.ynnx to export the model into YNNX format. It takes a brain.model as input, and the state is nothing but the input tensor, and this is the output model. This will get you convert the PyTorch into YNNX model. Okay, let me open the YNNX model and show you how it looks like. So this is the converted YNNX model. This will, again, the same neural network but represented in a different manner. This has clear segregation of, like, what is the input. Input is an array of 11 parameters, 3x3 grid, 9, and the number of earlier steps taken, and what is the last reward. Okay, and then it has the same neural network structure, like 11 into 20, 120 to 60, 60 to 30, 30 to 10, right? So this is how you validate between transitions, right, between PyTorch to YNNX. Does it really preserve my neural network state as it is, right? Is there any loss in between? So you can validate using Netron whether the conversion is successful or not, right? And then step two is, again, loading the YNNX file using the YNNX package. We need to have both YNNX and TensorFlow together because we are loading a YNNX, then preparing one input tensor. This TF rip is nothing but it's a utility class from YNNX TF package, which loads this YNNX model, and then, you know, takes the input tensor and you know, executes one cycle of execution to traverse the neural network to get its network graph, and then you can export the graph as PB, which is a TensorFlow thing. What happens here is actually to print the input and the output nodes. This can be ignored, okay? This is kind of, you know, kind of validation that I did, you know, what is being loaded has a proper input node and output node, and print the names of the same. Now let me open the PB. Right, now this starts looking weird. Okay, this is a TensorFlow format. You can still go and read this to see how it is implemented, but still, you can validate whether the input node still has the same passed in value. You can already see that, you know, it is starting with this 11, goes into, you know, multiplies with 120. Then you can, down the line, you can see 60. And then down the line, you can see 30 and 30 to 10. And then comes the output, which is 9. The output is an array of 9 numbers, which will give you the confidence value for each cell. If the neural network thinks that 0th cell is the next action to be taken, the confidence value given for that cell will be high than the rest of the cells. the neural network model doesn't give you that cell number 5 is the next click. It doesn't give that way, but rather it gives confidence values. I think the fifth cell, there is a 30% possibility. The rest of the cells like 5%, 15%, okay. So the way I have written the Android logic is that whichever cell has the highest confidence, that is the next tap, okay? Right. Then the final step is converting that PB model into TF light, which again uses the same TF. So this one is actually between within the TensorFlow itself. So ONNX is not needed. You load the TensorFlow model, and then this is something that I have done to print the input node names, input and output node names, which is mandated by the TF light converter. You need to provide the input array name here. 0 and 19 is the name of the input node and output node. So just to validate, you know, what is the names for that, I just did the previous steps. But otherwise, you can, if you already know what is the input node name and output node name, you can straight away hit this TF light converter and input the PB, input the input array name and the output array name, and then call the TF converter.convert, and then you persist this as a TF light model. Let me open that TF light model in the viewer. So this is the TF light model that persisted, that is given by the TF light converter. Here also you can see that the same neural network structure that was there in the previous steps is persisted here. 120 by 11, 120 to 60, 60 to 30, 30 to 10, and 10 to 9. 9 confidence values. And the output that I get is a single dimension array which has 9 elements. Clear? Okay. Now comes the interesting part. Let's go to our Android application. Presentation mode. Enter presentation mode. Okay, Puzzle Solver is the class. This should be calling next step. Go to implementation. Okay. I think I lost where written the actual Puzzle Solver. Okay. No, here it is. Okay. Right. So this is the Android code. So I use the Android SDK. Android SDK called has a class called interpreter. Interpreter takes a TF light model. We load the TF light model that we have converted. Okay. Then I call, there is a method called next step, okay, which will prepare the input and output nodes. The input is nothing but I prepare the current state of the matrix, okay, as a, you know, array of single integers. Then I call the AA.run with input and output. Output is nothing but a single two-dimensional array of, it's actually two-dimensional array having only one array with 9 elements, okay? I pass that, and from the returned values, as you can see here, as I already told you, my AI gives me the confidence value for each cell. So I need to take whichever the cell has a maximum confidence value as a next action. That's what I'm doing here. I'm taking the maximum value cell, and I'm performing that action as the next action for next move. Okay. And the way, so initially in the demonstration that I've shown, that it exactly took 5 steps to solve the problem. Can you tell me, is there any explanation for that? Because that was the behavioral enforcement that I gave it for training. If I come back to the training module, if the steps is less than or equal to 5, I bribed it more, right? So the neural network has optimized itself to solve the problem within 5 steps. We can reduce this, but if the problem is not solvable within that step, then it will go erroneous. So we need to, you know, keep that balance, optimal number of steps, you know, to keep the reward in an acceptable limit, right? It's more of a trial and error. So for the given problem space, we can estimate using mathematical models, but in this particular problem, I just took it from a trial and error basis. Because if you reduce this window to like 3 or 2 steps, then the learning curve doesn't happen. It just keeps on going on the negative graph. It doesn't learn at all. So by looking at the graph, we can decide, you know, what is that window which is optimal for the neural network to learn. I think that's all I have to present today. If you have any questions, I can take it.
Size of the hidden layers are taken automatically, or it is being assigned
That is the design that I did initially. So okay. This is also, this architecture design is also some trial and error. Okay, initially I started with only one hidden layer and started training the model, and looking at the graph, it did not learn at all. Okay, then I started adding one more layer, increase the neurons. So this is something that you need to do as a developer, you know, try to find the optimal neural network model. What is the best architecture that can fit to that particular problem space? This is something that is, again, trial and error. Right now, there is no scientific model that you can, you know, apply to this to arrive at, you know, okay, for this problem space, you can say 3 hidden layers. No, this more goes with by experience, intuition, and trial and error.
So whether we can change the size of hidden layer for each conversion, by which we can get the same output which we expected.
Yeah, you can optimize this model.
Okay.
You can try optimizing this model.
Thank you.
That was a good question. Actually, this is not, I'm not saying that this is the best model for this, right? You can still try to, you know, optimize your model, shrink it within, you know, fewer neurons and still achieve it. The thing is that, you know, games rely on FPS, right? Frames per second. If your calculation takes too long, then the game is not playable at all. Okay. After putting, if I went for algorithm based hint, right, this frame rate will get affected like anything. Because algorithmic models are CPU intensive, resource intensive, and they are greedy. If the algorithm is not optimally designed, then you won't get that FPS. When I went for this AI-based solution, it is like this. Within fraction of seconds, you get the results. Because it's the neural network which is giving the prediction, not algorithm. OK, any other questions? No, I mean, there is no performance difference. Because the neural network architecture remains the same across the frameworks. So there is no change in performance. Yes, yes. If you take for vision-based algorithms where you input image, like images with high-resolution images like 1280x720, where your matrix size is bigger, you know, training that model itself will be like very intensive task. So this model, I ran it like 3-4 hours to get the model trained. But in this vision-based models, it will take days. If you are running with your laptop, you need to go to cloud, you know, have enough chewing capacity so that you can run your models within hours. Yeah, training the model is always resource intensive. What I covered is only the consumption part of it. We need to move from, now we have enough, good enough number of trained models. Let's start consuming them, right?
ONNX model you've created, is it like, can be used cross-platform?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. It's portable. Cross-platform, cross-framework. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, thank you, Raj. It was a great session.
Any other questions?
Hi. It was good. So one doubt is when you build on TensorFlow, okay, and the model you are porting to TensorFlow Lite, okay, that runs on a mobile device with
yes.
low computing power.
Yes.
So what kind of compromises will it happen? Like
there is no compromise.
So
there is no compromise. Okay. Only thing is, you know, you can't run heavy computer vision based models in your mobile phone. So the model size itself will be huge. Take the example of this artistic style transfer. Okay, in my case, this trained model was like 500 KB. But when you take the artistic style transfer model, that itself is like 500 MB. The neural network that was built is 500 MB. Mobile phone will not be able to chew it.
Okay.
This is, see, again, I'm saying if you can divide and conquer, right? Divide the problem into smaller chunks and produce the AI only for the divided chunks, you'll be able to manage.
Okay.
Yeah. For those, you know, larger trained models, we still need to go for, you know, laptops or cloud-based execution environments. All right, thank you. Thanks for your patience.
So most of the participants who have done the registration would have got a mail for a feedback. We do kindly request you all to give us feedback to make this session all better and better for everyone. So that is a kind request, most humble request from us. Please do give us feedback. And then on the speakers, we are still looking for speakers. If you have a topic and you want to present on the stage is open. Have a talk with us. Let us know that you are interested. Thanks for making it to the session. Thank you so much.